Good morning. It works. Last night the sound system didn't work, and I shouted, and I didn't think I'd have a voice this morning. So you don't have a shouting preacher this morning. It is good to see you as we come together on this first Sunday of Advent, as we start our journey toward Christmas Eve, and the celebration of the birth of Christ, and the joy that we have in our hearts and lives as we relive the season where we sing some of the most beautiful songs, and as we share in the delight of that time, knowing that God is with us. We're glad you're here with us. And if you're with us for the first time, we invite you to take one of our Connect cards found in the pew, fill it out for us, and put it in the offering plate. And today we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. And as you know, as a part of our belief in our faith is that we believe in open communion. So everyone that is here this morning, you are welcome. You are welcome to come to this table and be a part of the experience with us. We have a few announcements to share with you. I have an announcement that Pastor Brian will be back in this pulpit next Sunday. Hallelujah. Now I know why younger pastors serve large churches. This has been quite a journey for me. So we're glad and delighted, though, to be on this staff, Pastor Jimmy and I. And we know that it is a privilege to fill in and support our senior pastor as we continue. Paige Turner has an announcement to make for us on behalf of our children's ministry.
Good morning. I know the weather outside may not make you think of summer, but in the church office, we have been planning for our summer of 2025. So in your bulletin, you will find an insert about our summer camps. And registration is live for both of our summer camps starting today. So if you want to get your kids signed up or grandkids signed up, just make sure you read all the information here. We have our Eagle Lake camp, which is going to be in June. It is June 23rd through the 27th. That is the day camp that we have here locally. It is held at our South Campus location. It's Monday through Friday. It's open to ages 6 to 12. And then if you have a teenager, 13 to 17, they can be part of the crew and help the camp counselors for the week. So we'll also be asking for volunteers. Many of you have volunteered for that in the past, whether it be a host home or helping with check-in and check-out or provide lunch during the day. So just know that that is coming. But registration is open today. There are early bird rates, so make sure you don't miss out on those. And then we also have our Eagle Sky overnight camp. That is going to be in July. It's July 14th through the 19th. It is open to ages 8 through 18, and that is held at Eagle Sky in Piedmont. So just a little ways away. It is a great week of activities and worship for all of our kids. Again, they have a kids camp and a teen camp. We do have a guaranteed limited number of spots available for Eagle Sky Camp. So if you have a kid or grandkid wanting to go to that, make sure you do get registered as soon as possible. And if you have any questions, you can see me after service or Amanda or Tyler. We'd be happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Paige. Thank you. You find another insert. There are two inside your bulletin today. On the back side, you see the trivia night experience that's forthcoming and the men's retreat. Invite all the men to be a part of that. Also, the Advent calendar, the events that will be taking place, and we hope that you will be a part of that. There's a next Sunday. There will be it's Saturday, right? The family program is on Saturday. Okay, good. So please be aware of that and the other activities that are there before us. I think there's some, Jackson Ministerial Alliance has their live nativity scene. I'm not sure, some of you may have signed up or be a part of that. Please look at the other announcements, if you will. We are grateful for some of our people who helped decorate our sanctuary. It looks beautiful, has majestic and beautiful presence about it. We're thankful for that experience and also to share in those things. There are a few of you here that I have yet to have the privilege to take your picture. So or the directory. And you do not have to be a member if you're participating here. We would love just to have your picture. So if you'll, after church, go back in the back of the church to the little round table. There's a card, and you sign your name, and I'll be taking pictures back in the back of the church. I'll be doing that next Sunday as well. So if you don't have all your family here, try to get them here, those that can be here, and we will get your picture, and we hope to start putting that together by the 1st of July. January. We might be the 1st of July, I don't know. But I think it'd rather be January, and we hope to do that. So again, it's good to celebrate and share together. Look at the announcements and the activities and the experiences that we have here. See where our communion offering today goes to the Susanna Wesley Learning Center, and just a number of different things that we have involved. We're a busy church, and that is good. That means a lot of interaction, a lot of people participating, and we're grateful for that. And as we share, as we begin to unfold the events of this first Advent Sunday, I invite you to stand and let us join together in singing together with the choir the first verse of O Come, Emmanuel.
From deep in the past, Jeremiah calls to us. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Jeremiah 33:14. Beloved, the days are surely coming when the yearning of the land, the longing of the sun, moon, and stars, the desperate need of the people of the earth for flourishing and peace will receive their fulfillment.
While fear, anxiety, misinformation, and suspicion surround us on every side, we choose to watch and wait in hope, preparing our hearts to notice and cooperate with God's grace already at work in our midst.
We light this candle of hope as a sign of our commitment to pay attention and prepare for the days that are surely coming and are already here. The days when God's kingdom of love, justice, and mercy will reign.
Let us join together in singing, O Come, Come, Thou Long-Expected Jesus.
Thank you. seated. As we share this prayer time together, we're reminded that there are those among us who have many, many issues. Many names there represent issues and concerns that they have. And the fact that they have trust in your prayers. So as we pray today, we invite you to take the list before you and in your heart, name each of those people in your own heart and mind as we lift them up in our prayers. We especially want to remember our pastor and his family during this time of the passing of his father. We also want to remember the Ellis family during this time of the passing of Dottie and also with John's condition. So as we pray today, I would urge you to look at the names on the list, and as we pray, ask God's blessings of peace and healing and wholeness for every single individual. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we gather in this beautiful place with your beautiful people to acknowledge your presence among us. We have come through the months of the year to the beginning of a new year, the beginning of Advent. And as we share this service together today, Lord, we're reminded that centuries ago, you involved yourself in a very special way to save us all. So today we open our lives, our hearts, our minds to the presence of your holy will. And we invoke your blessings to be upon every single individual that's named in this list. Lord, you know the needs of each one better than any of us know. We only know that we care, and we only know that we want the very best of healing and wholeness for every single individual. It's in that spirit we lift our voices together, praying together the prayer you taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us turn in our hymnals now to hymn number 206. Number 206, stand together as we sing. Remain standing for the reading of the lesson. Let us stand.
Our Old Testament this morning is from the reading of Malachi, chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. Look, I am sending you the prophet Elijah before the great dreadful day of the Lord's arrival. His preaching will turn hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse. From the New Testament, reading from the Gospel of Luke, Chapter 1, verses 5 through 23. When Herod was king of Judea, there was a Jewish priest named Zechariah. He was a member of the priestly order of Abijah, and his wife Elizabeth was also from the priestly line of Aaron. Zechariah and Elizabeth were righteous in God's eyes, careful to obey all the commandments and regulations. They had no children because Elizabeth was unable to conceive, and they were both very old. One day, Zechariah was serving in the temple, for his order was on duty that week. As it was the custom of the priests, he was chosen by lot to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and burn incense. While the incense was being burned, a great crowd stood outside praying. While Zechariah was in the sanctuary, an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing to the right of the incense altar. Zechariah was shaken and overwhelmed with fear when he saw him. But the angel said, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. God has heard your prayer. Your wife, Elizabeth, will give you a son. You are to name him John. You will give great joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He must never touch wine or other alcoholic drinks. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even before his birth. And he will turn from many Israelites to the Lord their God. He will be a man with the spirit and power of Elijah. He will prepare the people for the coming of the Lord. He will turn their hearts to their fathers, to their children, and he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the godly." Zechariah said to the angel, "How can I be sure this will happen? I am an old man now, and my wife is also well along in years." Then the angel said, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the very presence of God. It was he who sent me to bring you this good news. But now, since you didn't believe what I said, you will be silent and unable to speak until the child is born. For my words will certainly be fulfilled at the proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah to come out of the sanctuary, wondering why he was taking so long. When he finally did come out, he couldn't speak to them. Then they realized from his gestures and his silence that he must have seen a vision in the sanctuary. When Zechariah's week of service in the temple was over, he returned home. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
Thank you for that beautiful anthem. When I think about Advent, I think about the time that we, as the world watches out for Christ, to see the spirit of our lives connecting as we recognize it with the spirit among us in Christ Jesus. It is also a time when our spirits speak to the spirit of God, and where we hear him speak to us, speak to our hearts in different ways. Whether it is going back to a time in our childhood, our parenting, our grandparenting, wherever it may be, is a time where we recognize that love speaks to love. It's a time where something happens that we sometimes can't identify with words, but with emotion and feeling. And a time where we have a sense of knowing that we draw near to a place in our faith journey that seeks from us a commitment to be prepared for whatever God may offer us in our life's journey. If I were to ask you this morning to tell the Christmas story, where would you begin? Where would you begin in that story? I suspect that many of us would be inclined to use the words in the Gospel of Luke, the memorable words that said, "And in those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be enrolled." We would start at that place and share that. On the other hand, there might be those of us who might step a little bit to that place where the angel Gabriel speaks to Mary and says, "Hail, O favored one, the Lord is with you." Or we might take that moment, look a little further, maybe into more in-depth theologically, and find a place in John's gospel where it simply said, "And the Word became flesh, and it dwelt among us." Some of us may love the ancient connection of the Christmas story with Israel in the Old Testament, where it said, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Any of these places would be a good place to start the story of Christmas. But I think Luke is one that shares with us better than anyone else the context of the story as he foretells the awareness of what took place. Now, Zechariah and Elizabeth had waited a long time for God to answer their prayer. They had become to that particular age in their life where they knew that they probably, it would never be answered. And so what happens, Zechariah is one of many priests. There was something like 20,000 priests. And the way you became a priest is that you were born into a priestly family. So therefore, it just grew. And they would cast lot for one to go at high times and special times of the year into the Holy of Holies and give the incense to make holy and clean and purify the place of where the gods would be spoken to on behalf of the people. And it says that it so happened that Zechariah was chosen. That had to be exciting. That had to be special because this was a once-in-a-lifetime experience. And to think of all the thousands of priests that had that opportunity. And so he goes and he is inside the temple. The people are waiting outside. They have come along to be a part of the experience. They're excited for him and know this is a special chapter in his life. And so as the time takes place in this moment, he goes in and he is there. Now, story has been told that no one else would go into the Holy of Holies except the priest. And people were so fearful of God, some scholars said that they even tied ropes, a rope around the leg of the priest, just in case something happened where they could pull him back out, because no one could go in to take care of him if something happened. Can you imagine that experience? Well, I don't think that Luke mentions that, but anyhow, he's in the Holy of Holies. And an angel appears. An angel appears. And all of a sudden, there's a conversation. Now, the angel doesn't tell his name at first in the conversation that takes place. But the angel tells him something, and as Richard read the scripture, we, in the context of that, could see that it was so overwhelming to Zechariah that he just couldn't believe it. There's just some things in life that happen that we just can't believe. Can't believe our very eyes saw something that happened that's so unusual. And as I read the context of this scripture, I think of three words this morning. I want to briefly share with you three words. And think about this. Zechariah's encounter with the angel Gabriel. The first word is waiting. The scripture tells us about waiting. Waiting. We see it's been 400 years before God has actually spoken verbally to someone. Moses was the last one he spoke to. The prophets had been the ones who had been proclaiming and sharing. And the angel now comes and brings the word of God. There's all this waiting that's been taking place. You know, sometimes we think of waiting in a negative sense. I don't know how many hours over the years of ministry that I share that I have spent in a waiting room with families after a surgery or a test. Or maybe even every once in a while there for the birth of a child, knowing that there might be some complications, and the family invited me to come and sit with them. Waiting. Waiting sometimes can be so long. And then you're at that particular place where all of a sudden you've waited so long that you're all of a sudden you start thinking negative thoughts because there's no answer yet. And so you get anxious. And sometimes the anxiety overwhelms you. John Calvin said, "There is no place for faith if we expect God to fulfill immediately everything he promises." But we live in that particular mindset, don't we? We want God to answer things immediately in our lives. We learn in waiting patience and humility. I remember several times waiting back in the back of the church before a wedding with the groom and the groomsmen, and how fidgety and how nervous the groom gets, and how everybody else, that nervousness kind of moves over and infiltrates the minds of the groomsmen as well, and how I tried to find ways to lighten the load a little bit, and maybe sometimes a little humorous thought, but realizing that it would all be over in a few moments. They would walk out in the front of the church and stand looking at the back of the door, and the groom is just kind of, he just all tense, and then that door opens and that beautiful, beautiful young lady, and he looks and he says, "Oh my gosh, what have I gotten into?" Some of us have been there. We know what that feels like. But the waiting has been resolved. It is dissolved in that one moment of elation. Well, in that one moment of elation, there is a counteracting experience. And it says, you know, we cannot make things happen on our own apart from God in Christian faith. Christmas is a reminder to us. We can't make things happen apart from God in our relationship of faith. Well, then it says, as Zechariah enters the temple in order to engage in this once-in-a-lifetime experience as an act as one of the priests on the behalf of the people, it says something that's very important, which involves the second word, hearing. Hearing. Zechariah was the priest, and one of the most beautiful things about the simple fact in that day was that in this once of a lifetime, all of a sudden, his heart, I am certain, was beating hard. And he knew that the people who had gathered to support him and the people of the family of Israel, everything, all that weight was upon his shoulders, but the joy of knowing that he was doing something on behalf of them in the presence of the Holy of Holies and God. An angel appears. And he says, now I don't know what kind of voice he said it in, but he probably said it. Zechariah, do not be afraid, for your prayer has been heard. Wow. Now, if I thought that I was the only one in the Holy of Holies and all of a sudden a voice happens and there's someone there beside me, I think I might get a little bit scared. But he says, do not be afraid, for your prayer has been heard. The word Zechariah means God remembers. How appropriate. God remembers. You know, hearing is one of the things of which I have struggled with in the last few years, and in the context of being able to hear, my hearing has been lost more and more, it seems, month after month. I'm reminded, though, of a story of our oldest grandson. He was in kindergarten. His teacher was Miss Shaw. And they had a particular program that they had so many students in that program, they could have a teacher's aide, a helper. And her name was Mrs. Lawrence. Well, Colton comes home and he's all upset. He says, Mrs. Lawrence, today was her last day because my classmates has moved, and therefore, because that number is down, we cannot have Mrs. Lawrence anymore. And his dad said, well, that's a dumb rule. Now remember, this is a kindergartner. That's a dumb rule. So the next day, he goes back to school, and anxious as he is, he raises his hand. Mrs. Shaw, Mrs. Shaw. He says, what? What? What, Colton? He says, my dad said if we can get one more dumb kindergartner, we can get Mrs. Lawrence back. Hearing is sometimes how we hear. How we hear. And when I see that 25-year-old young man now, I think of that story. Hearing. Hearing is an important thing. And in the midst of that hearing, Zechariah is overwhelmed. And there's a last word that comes to this story, and it's really no word at all. It's silence. Just like the silence of the hope candle. Silence. There'd been silence for so long, and now God had spoken. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says, we are to be silent at the beginning of each day so that God can have the first word, and we are to be silent at the end of the day so that God can have also the last word. If you think about the gospel stories, think about this. In each of the gospels, the word comes from the silence. In John, it is silence at the beginning of creation. For Luke, it is the silence of poor Zechariah, struck dumb by the angel Gabriel for doubting that Elizabeth could bear a child. For Matthew, it is the awkward silence of Joseph and Mary talking to each other about what has happened that the angel Gabriel had spoken to her. For the Gospel of Mark, it is the voice of one crying in the wilderness, long forgotten. Very few people come to see me and over the years come to discuss what God has said to them. But many people have come, a large majority have come to say God hasn't said anything to them. He hasn't answered their prayers. And sometimes when we speak on behalf of something enormous that has happened in our life, we have a tendency to shrink it down. Zechariah says, can you just imagine? Here he is, and it says, Zechariah, hey, God has found favor with you. And he said, how can it be? I'm an old man. And the angel says, well, I'm Gabriel, and this is what God says. In the midst of that moment, we have a tendency to shrink things down. Yet, when we speak of great things, sometimes they swallow us whole. But instead, we should be swallowed by them. So the angel claims, he simply says, you are going to have a child, and his name will be called John the Baptist, and he will make ready for the Lord a people prepared. More than anything else, I hope for all of us this season that in our prayers we have in a journey of faith, there will be a prayer that we will be a people prepared for whatever may come our way, knowing that God, even though it may be in the silence of the moment, God will have the last word. He really cares. And for that, as we prepare ourselves this morning for the sacrament, we're going to stand and join together in singing the first and third verse of O Little Town of Bethlehem. Let us join together. You may be seated. And I'm going to use the abbreviated form of the sacrament this morning, so you don't need to turn to page 17, okay? One of the great mysteries and joys of knowing in our life of faith, we know that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. And every time we partake of the sacrament, we are reminded of that. We're reminded of the story of how in the liturgy we talk to God. We give God thanks for watching over us, for caring for us, for loving us, and seeking of us to know that as we follow in the path, that every time we come to this table, we come to humble ourselves in preparation for God's guidance and love and the deliverance of every day. And that is so important. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. And he told the disciples, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this often in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. He poured the wine in and said, "This is my blood, which was shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins and also for the privilege of knowing that you are loved beyond recognition and unconditionally forever." So when we take this bread and we take this cup, we're ever reminded of God's love and care for us in the joy of sharing. As I said earlier, we have open communion. Everyone here is welcome. If there may be those of you who need gluten-free, we have that here as well. And what you need to do,
Just remember, our ministry goes on beyond the walls of this building. Go in peace. May the blessing of the Lord be upon us all. There's refreshments downstairs, fellowship time. Everybody's welcome.